Hello everyone, I'm Natalia Diaz. I am researcher and lecturer at INSTA, Paris Tech, and also part of the Flowers INRIA team. I'm going to talk about a recent survey of us, work joint with Timothée Lessard sitting first line, David Filia, and Jean-François Goudou. And this is a recent work we have been after written after researching the state representation literature. So a brief introduction about me. So I guess images say more than 1,000 words. So these are a summary of institutions where I have studied, work, or received grants from. I did my PhD in Finland after my degree in University of Granada, and did a bunch of internships and postdocs here and there. So what project we're working on? It's called DREAM, which stands for Deferred Restructuring of Experience in Autonomous Machines. In this project, we are focused on learning and in open-ended environments where the task is not always well predefined. There is no supervision, and we care about how we can compress the relevant knowledge and how to transfer it to new tasks. And we use concepts like curiosity or representation redescription. So we have basically two stages in the project. We have the daytime, which is like us humans. When we learn during the day, we basically collect data and learn tasks. We perform knowledge improvement, knowledge adaptation, knowledge validation. Then we have the night time, which in our case for robots will be when the robot is off or when it's sleeping, the sleeping time, out of electricity, for instance. So in that time, we have the knowledge restructuring and the transfer from short-term memory to long-term memory. And this actually happens, this is where the consolidation of knowledge happens, and it's where different contexts in similar situations can be applied in order to learn new tasks. In new situations, we will find new motivations for the next day, go on. In the real life, the DREAM project sounds very nice, but this is how it looks in real life. So we have experiments with different robots. Here, this robot needs to put this cube into this cube. And Robobo here, which is this robot that carries a phone. It's actually a kickstarted project from Spain. He doesn't have arms, but it can push the goal closer to this robot. So when it's out of reach, it actually can achieve the goal. We also have the same environment here, very similar, where the ball can be brought closer so that Baxter can actually put the ball inside the basket. And here we have a bunch of timios which collaboratively have shown to perform better if the same budget is distributed among robots. It's actually the goal, the performance is higher than if we distribute the same budget across one. So this is just one example. We are now familiar with Olivier's presentation about this setting. And state representation learning will focus actually on this gray area. So basically, we will learn a function that, given an observation, typically an image, will provide a state that it's useful for a policy to choose the most optimal action. But first of all, why learning states? So basically, because often controllers actually require a simpler way of being programmed. So if we have a robot that needs to grasp an object, so we will care about the position of the object. If we have a driving, an autonomous car, we will care about the direction of the road. And it's easier, it's of course easier to program this with this low-dimensional dimension. And this also makes us learn states that are more independent on the state, on the environment, and can easily transfer. So we need basically some filtering of what features are relevant. This is sometimes handcrafted, but we will work in unsupervised setting. So in back to our project, in Dream, learning a state will basically mean discarding all irrelevant information that is not useful for the task. So for instance, during the sleep time. In this presentation, so I focus on the survey we wrote. So basically, I start with some formalism, what good state means. Also different learning objectives. We can use different models, forward, inverse, reconstruct the observation. All these are different tasks, auxiliary tasks that have another objective, but that help us learning a state. And then we have different tools that are repeated across the literature in order to facilitate the implementation of these models, such as autoencoders, Siamese networks, etc. And finally, we'll talk about how SRL can be used in autonomous agents and some challenges and evaluation metrics. So, wait, what is a good state? So, we are dealing in our project with a lot of robotic arms, but a state should be any characterization of the environment, generally. So, the Markovian view says that a good state representation is one that is Markovian. This means that all the necessary information is actually compressed and summarized into the current state, and it allows to perform a policy that can be reached and can be improved over time. So it means that the state should be able to represent the true value of the current state, and it also should generalize for new similar futures. So this could be if we teach a robot to push a button, it should be easier for him to turn the light on or to call an elevator, because there are different kinds of buttons. So it should help. And also the state should be low dimensional because it's more efficient to estimate, but also it's more interpretable. So it's also easier for designers, humans. So some of the challenges of state representation learning normally is the lack of direct supervision. As I said, the actual true state, it's not unique, it's not always available. So we will assume we don't have a true state in our work. Other challenges is that we can use self-supervised learning as a solution to do that, for instance, predicting the future. So this could be a way of using self-supervision. And then we can, of course, exploit observations, actions, and rewards, which is not always used. And then we will look at different complementary approaches, as I said. So just as a notation, summary notation, we have a nomenclature here in which we will have the real world, in which we have the real states with S tilde, from which performing an action will give the next one. So we will have an observation which might be partial about the real state. From this observation, we will learn a state, which can be used to estimate the next state, for instance. So this is basically the schema we are going to play with. So one example, you might be wondering what can SRL be used for. In our case, we start very simple because we don't want to program the robot to push a button. We want him to learn the task that he needs to push a button. So in this case, we want to learn a relevant state, just from pixels, actions, and rewards. So in this case, we have that the robot will get a positive point in red if he actually pushes the button, and the light will light pink. Zero otherwise if it's out of sight or if it's in a safe sphere close to the button, and minus one if the arm goes out of reach. This is how the ground truth looks like if we would plot it. And we will use robotic priors to help constrains the state space in an unsupervised manner. Antonin, sitting at the end, will present more details about this work tomorrow. So we have different learning objectives that can help learning state representations. So some are a family that deal with giving an input. We want to reconstruct the same input, given the observation. So these are all autoencoders, the noising autoencoders, variation autoencoders. Others are learning forward models. There are others that combine different objectives, etc. So as a broader overview, what are the applications of state representation learning? So we can, generally, reinforcement learning is one of the general application and self-supervision architectures. For instance, when the loss can be used as its own reward, this shares the same architecture as actor critic, but we have here different elements, other architectures where this can be useful, learning a state, like reward winning, dynamic verification, where you have several inputs, one is corrupted, and at the end we output the one that is, the network needs to learn which one of them is actually corrupted. We can learn inverse dynamics or reconstruction. But we can also use states for transfer learning, for multimodal observation learning. So if we have states, we can combine with the sensor fusion for easier, for instance, autonomous driving. Or we also believe that, despite not having been tested, that this can be useful accelerating evolutionary strategies. This will be part of our next interns, probably. So what the movie is about, or what the game is about, this is some of the to make it simple. We will have the family of autoencoders, which will care about the observation and the reconstruction of it, the forward model, which will compare actually the losses between actual next state and the predicted next state, inverse models, which will focus on the loss function according to predicted action, and models with priors, which enforce different constraints in between states and involving actions and optionally rewards. And of course, these models can all be combined, such as here. But what is important is that the most promising approaches usually blend some of these approaches. Unlike in the Parchís game, the Spanish game, all ways lead to learn state, which is what we want. So first of all, autoencoder models, they basically train a state that is sufficient, like GANs are, to reconstruct the observation. So then, they normally can work quite well, but when we have task irrelevant features or salient aspects in the image, they basically don't work as well. So basically, we will have a state that is learned from an observation with a parametrization phi. And then the inverse function should be able to recover, given the estimated state, the original observation. One example paper on using autoencoders is deep spatial autoencoders from FIN, which learns a representation that corresponds to object coordinates in the image pixel space. In this case, we encode the features about the image, FT, but because there is torque control and second order dynamic system for this task, we will need not only the features in the final full state, FT, but also the velocities of these features. This is because the task that it's tested on in robotics is like moving some Lego block or transferring a bag of rice into a pan or scooping some other object or hanging an object on a hook. So the idea is that this continuous control trajectory-centric reinforcement learning uses very simple Gaussian mixture model priors, but it results in very efficient optimization, even when the amount of samples is smaller than the dimension, and when we have unknown dynamics. So basically, we train a controller using the data collected, we learn visual features, and then the final state is trained with the collected data and those features. Another the other second family of models is the forward models, in which we need to find a state from which is easy to predict next one. Here we impose constraints that can be that the underlying dynamics are linear, or we want to discover relevant features, or this might be useful in different model-based reinforcement learning. In fact, it's used in many a sub-model in many other broader systems. So basically, we have a state and an action, and we want to figure out what next state that action will lead us to. This is an example of how the loss is computed in the intrinsic curiosity model, but this is just one example. I will talk later about it. In the forward model example, we have the value prediction network, which actually has four components. The first one is an encoding of the state into of the observation input into a state. Then we have the outcome, which actually works on options, which are basically a temporal abstraction on time for different hierarchies of actions. So giving a state and an option, it predicts at every instance the reward and the discount factor. We have the value function, giving the value for that particular state. And the last module is the transition module, that giving a state and an option gives us next state. So that's why it's a forward model. This is similar to the value functions learning forward models in model-free reinforcement learning that actually outperforms DQN. And the dynamics are blended together with planning. So here I show how it actually performs. So this is the collect domain, where there is an agent needs to reach several goals. You can see in the average reward, they both use deterministic and stochastic. And they compare with different this-step planning. So as Olivier introduced before, this is shows a kind of intermediate trade-off. So based on different values of step planning ahead, the best performance is higher at the highest look ahead step dimension. You can look more details in the paper. The third family of models is inverse models. So in this case, we're giving a state, and we are giving also the future state we want to reach, and we need to figure out the action that leads us there. So this state should be sufficient to find these two actions and serve to be useful in a direct control model. So we can likewise also establish constraints as previously with linear model, enforcing linear models in the underlying functionality, or focusing on states that can be controlled in certain manner depending on other constraints that we might be interested in predicting. So this is the general loss function and parametrization. One example of inverse model is this intrinsic curiosity model. This was my favorite paper from last year, in which they define curiosity actually by as the error in the agent's prediction of the consequence of its own actions in a visual feature space. So basically, the error of the they both use a forward model and an inverse model, and the prediction error of the forward model is actually the intrinsic reward, which is basically the curious element for the curious agent. And this makes very nice mix, because in this case rewards are optional. So if you have them, extrinsic reward is used, but if you don't, you internally generate it with the forward model. And it bypasses something that many other models try to do, which is not what we want, which is predicting pixels, because that might not be the only objective we care about when we're learning states, because they might not be all relevant for our task there. So the only inconvenient I see is that it's not tested in robotics. So, but we are working on that.
Actually, I think this approach is not made to, actually, will not work very well in robotics. I think we already discussed this, because basically the representation that is learned is based on the principle that you explained, that you try to have a representation which, given the state at t plus 1 and the state at t, you try to reconstruct the action that led to this transition. But the problem in robotics is that systems are very often redundant, in the sense that there is many and sometimes an infinite amount of actions that can lead to the same transition. So actually, I would say that for most real-world robotics application, it cannot be tested, because it cannot be applied right from the beginning.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Maybe I can make a smaller. But then, can't you make a representation of your action and then try to predict that one?
You mean a representation of the action that the system would have taken?
So, for example, you have redundant action space, so your many actions can lead to the same result. But for example, then you would love to extract the representation of this action, which would be equivalent for all these actions.
I'm not sure there is a simple. That there is some kind of representation of action that are that.
Well, for example, if you're talking about simple navigation task, you can get in multiple ways to last point. But then, like, internal representation would be displacement, and you could learn displacement instead of the actual sequence of actions.
Yes, but the displacement, if there is a wall in between, is not an action that is existing.
Indeed.
So. Yeah, I'm not sure. I think this one is not the approach most suited to robotics.
Overall, I think you're completely right. Maybe a possibility would be to have some distribution of action, probability of actions, but just to form an inverse model to predict what would be the distribution of possible actions. It could be a way to deal with different actions from the same state. Yeah. And after that, usually with observation, they are very close in time. So usually, you have variation, but it's not a very long-term planning, so you don't have so much possibilities to go from one thing to another. But you're right, it's not direct application.
Okay. Yeah. Here you can see that one of the main advantages of this model is that the curious A3C agent, the algorithm in which they test this algorithm, significantly outperforms baseline A3C agent as the sparsity of rewards increases. So they test for dense reward, sparse reward, and very sparse reward. Here you can see these are the curious agent rooms visited, so there are much more rooms explored than with the random exploration. And this is in the BizDome environment. So, okay, let's move on. So with the prior models, the last big family of models, here we have very varied cocktail of different priors that can be used depending on your task. So we encode knowledge about physics laws, Newton's laws, normally general rules about how the environment works, such as temporal continuity, controllability, because the actions that the robot can control are those that we care about, inertia, rewards might be exploited. So we will use a set of states and parametrization for a given context that will allow us to formulate one loss function per prior that we are using. You might be wondering, when I speak about robotic priors, if we are speaking about the Bayesian prior probability. If you think so, you are wrong. No, we are meaning about a priori knowledge about the world. So basically, something that can be known without experience or sense data. So if Socrates has more wine than Plato and Plato has more wine than Aristotle, then Socrates has more wine than Aristotle. This is common sense. Our brothers are male siblings. So to move on, robotic priors were originated in John Chomsky paper. Basically use a priori knowledge to learn representations that are relevant for the task. That's the main idea. This is encoded in four original priors that basically each one is a loss function, you can see here. So the temporal coherence prior says that the two states close to each other in time should also be close to each other in the state space. The proportionality says that two identical actions should result in two proportional magnitude state variations. Repetibility that two identical actions apply a similar state should provide similar state variations not only in magnitude but also direction. And the causality prior says if two states are on which the same action is applied and we get different reward, they should be far away in the latent space. So this is some of the these are some of the environments in which the priors are validated, which are much closer to our interest in robotics. So we have a racing car here, in which, given this image, we try to learn a state. We have higher rewards in red. We have two cars, one is controllable by the robot and the other is distracting. So this is for the controllable, and for the distracting you can see that the higher rewards in the controllable car highly correlate with the position of higher rewards, so it geometrically makes sense. And then we have also a mobile robot here in a room in which he gets positive reward if he goes to this corner, and in the state space learn, you can see that basically it's coherent with the geometry of the physical space. So all the positive rewards are positive reward states are coherently located, and also the trajectories. Also more experiments, we can add domain randomization. This works well in these simple environments. However, when we transfer to robotics, domain randomization is not so well handled by the priors. And this is the paper we brought on a benchmark that pushed the limits and, of the priors. You can see it's in archive. And here you can see also the return per learn state, which is actually quite close to if we will use the actual position of the robot, which we are not using. So this is quite good news, meaning that our results are close to using ground truth without actually using it. And as a second version of robotics priors deals with position velocity encoders. So basically they encode an observation into a position state and a velocity estimation. So for the velocity state, two different timestamp positions are taken into account, while for the acceleration, two different timestamps for the velocity are taken into account, and these are two combined. So these are other priors. For instance, variation says positions of relevant things vary, and therefore representations of such positions as well vary. Slowness means positions change slowly. Inertia assumes the same as slowness applied to velocities instead of positions. And then we have conservation, which means velocity magnitudes change slowly. Basically, the energy is conserved. And the amount of energy or movement in consecutive time steps should be also similar in time. And the controllability says that controllable things, those whose accelerations correlate with the actions of the robot, are those relevant, and therefore we care about it. So these are, if you are curious, each of these loss functions can be encoded into different loss function, as you can see here. This is tested in Mujoko environments. such as the inverted pendulum, card pole, bowling cup, and you can see that the neural fitted key iteration algorithm used here with trained position velocity encoder works much better than the rest. And also you can see that the geometry very highly correlates with the movements of such environments, where here the red states are high reward, positive reward. Here we have, they do experiments with fixed camera, moving camera, and you can see here the encoding over time. Other objective functions can be selectivity, for instance, which assumes that a good representation should be disentangled representation of variation factors that generate it. However, one problem is that we are not always knowing all the factors that generate the data, or might not be easily obtainable or interpretable. Also assumes if the actions are known to be independent, it measures the independence among variations of the representation under each action. You can see more in Thomas' paper. Another example where different objective functions are combined is an elegant paper called Embed to Control, where the model learns the mean and the and supplementary parameters for the variance, here the encoder of the distribution of the data, and it learns a state. In this case, the future state is computed as a locally linear combination of previous state and previous action, where all these three matrices can be fixed or learned. And this is used for sampling. So given the action and these matrices learn, we can compute the next state, which is actually compared with the actual next state through the KL divergence. This can be compared with the future state. So this part is symmetric. For details, you can see more in the paper. We are trying to combine these principles with the GANs. We don't have very conclusive results yet. So as a summary, we have talked about models that actually have constraints on the actions and next state space. Here you can see a list of models from embedded to control, the encoders, priors. And then you can see which ones use a forward model, an inverse model, which ones reconstruct the observation. Some predict next observation, basically predicting pixels that we talked earlier. And some use rewards. So there is a big zoo, again, of models, and it's hard to make a clear pattern. Here, the table continues. Reward-weighted principal component analysis, then they extend the intrinsic curiosity module here with some homeostatic drive to keep yourself more regulated in the same state. This is kind of a regularization of the intrinsic curiosity model we saw before. Different GANs, and you can see more in the actual survey. So now we saw all the big families of models. Now the tools that facilitate this model implementation will be described. So we start with the family of autoencoders, Siamese network, GANs, and other objectives. So this is the zoo of autoencoders, another zoo. We can see, you can look at it from different representation, the first row or the second row. In the first row, you can see the basic vanilla autoencoder. You have an input, a function which you learn a state, and this state should be able through data to provide back the reconstruction of your input. Now we have the dotted lines are sampling, so we sample noise in the input for the denoising autoencoder, while for the variation autoencoder, the noise is actually injected into the state. And for the actual input, we learn the mean and standard deviation of the data distribution, which are actually used to compute the state. Here you can see a bit more detail or different representation where we have the classical autoencoders, which is a bottleneck, where the compact and relevant representation is under complete, meaning we have a bottleneck in the middle. Then we have the variational autoencoder, where we have the probabilistic hidden cells, the denoising autoencoder with noise in the beginning. All of them have the reconstruction objective at the end in red, which means they need to match input to output. And the sparse autoencoder, which has actually, instead of a bottleneck, it has an overcomplete representation because it has more cells in the latent space. And then we have stacked autoencoders, which basically are deep belief networks, which are equivalent to stacked RBMs, restricted Boltzmann machines, or variation autoencoders. And different levels encode different features. So autoencoders work quite well in many tasks for state representation learning. However, as I mentioned earlier, domain randomization or irrelevant saliency aspect are not, they don't cope as well. As a bit more detailed image of the variational autoencoder, you can see here that the encoder learns an encoding of the data distribution, mean and variance, that allows us to choose the state. And this is decoded. This serves to decode the actual input. And the objective of the variational autoencoders is to maximize a variational lower bound, in which we use an auxiliary variational function Q, which approximates P of X and C by elbow. This translates to this longer KL divergence expression. Another tool that helps in state representation learning, and it's also widely used, is Siamese networks. They basically have the structure that looks like this. So you have identical copy of your network in which the weights are shared or tied. You can hear both. Basically, the weights are the same. The high dimensional input makes an output of that is lower dimensional, which translates with a loss function into an energy function that produces the scalar loss. Basically, these networks learn a similarity metric from data, and it's very suitable in verification tasks. Ideally, they can be used for in face recognition. You can have two pictures of Natalia and say, are these the same or person or it's another? So this works well when the number of categories is large and unknown, and they serve to implement priors too. Because if we need to compare two different states in time or two different rewards, it allows us to do it in parallel. However, the downside is that if the network occupies a lot, you will double size in memory. This might be an issue, and it's not always needed. So another very useful tool is generative adversarial networks, which basically encodes a two-player minimax game in which the objective is to reach some Nash equilibrium between generator and discriminator. Our value function will draw samples from the real data and samples C from the state generated data. And this is basically we will have a generator that generates data that looks like real from, and the aim will be to fool the discriminator, which needs to say if the output is real or fake. So one will be if fake, zero if real, and binary cross entropy loss is usually used in this case. And these are the formal laws for discriminator and generator. The GAN that we found useful, or most close, that could help us in stereo representation learning, we have been working on is the VGAN, in which we have the classical discriminator where we, instead of adding, instead of inputting the data, we also input the latent representation of that input observation. And we need to determine if this is real data or fake. This is the reason why we need an extra encoder that is a mirror of the discriminator, of the generator, sorry. No. The discriminator. We need to, basically we need the features and the data both inputted at the same time, and the bidirectionality of the network allows us to compare both laws to match, not just one way. Here is the actual loss function for discriminator and generator for both parts. We have been testing these experiments with not so clear conclusions. It learns some states in simple environments, but we have not tested as much with actual robotics, so this is still ongoing work. And it's interesting to mention that the same formulation, the exact same function and architecture, it's also proposing adversarially learned inference, which was work done in parallel. These are some of the generated images. This is, for instance, the input images, and these are generated fake ones. Basically, some quantitative results. So we have talked about several tools that help in the state representation learning. Now, how to evaluate? Once we have learned a state, evaluating it, there is not a standard procedure. So we made a table with all the dimensionality of each state learned, as well as the observation dimensionality. So the larger the dimensionality of the input is, of course, results in more difficulties learning. You can see that very few of them use actually a minimal state representation. Some go up to 96, 32, 12, 512 internal representation. Of course, this actually, it's still much lower than thousands of pixels that an image has, so it's still learning a more compact representation and should be more efficient. But the take home message is that the larger the dimensionality, the better performance generally, but at the cost of losing interpretability. So this is a trade-off we need to make. In terms of environments, there is no clear standard at all. This is what makes the field so difficult to compare and to advance. We have inverted pendulums, card pools, Wisdom, Atari games, octopus arms, mobile robots, algorithms. In robotics, manipulation skills, which are the ones we care about, we have for grasping an object, balancing a pendulum, poking objects, or pushing a button. These are the benchmarks we have created. They will be open source very soon, and some of them can be seen in our benchmark paper, extending and proving the robotic priors. These are some of the OpenAI baselines, which are a good start to test the states in reinforcement learning. Mountain car, Acrobot, I guess most of you are familiar with this. I put an image also of the octopus arm, which basically has as objective reaching any point, any position. and has this formulation. And then we have in the robotics SoftBank Pepper doing the bowling cup. So there is a very heterogeneous cocktail of evaluation techniques. Now, when it comes to metrics, of course, it's clear to us that performing well in reinforcement learning is the best metric. If our state works in reinforcement learning, it's clear that we learn a useful state. But this is not always easy. It's very sample inefficient reinforcement learning. It's very slow. Simulators fail a lot. And we need while developing other metrics. So we can look at the disentanglement metrics score, which looks at the latent generating factors, useful for transfer learning. However, it assumes that all the factors are known and interpretable, like in the DeepSprites data set. It's very nice data set, but you assume you know that the object can change in size, in rotation, in form. I think there is 4 latent variations. And this is not normally the case for us. When we have an image, an observation of the world, what are the latent generating factors? So, also the distortion preserves local and global geometry coherence. This goes more or less hand in hand or similar to NIECA. However, normalization independent embedding quality assessment is a metric that looks at the local and global neighborhood for assessing the quality, and it's not limited to isometric embeddings. And finally, we propose another metric looking at the neighbors. So we assume that neighbors in the ground truth input space, ground truth space, should be also neighbors in the state representation space. So this actually correlated quite well with NIECA. So as to conclude, some future challenges or directions. So we want to achieve state representation learning that is useful for autonomous agents. We need to work on the assessment, how to make it so that we can iterate, the reproducibility, as it was said before, and interpretability. There are key issues that are not there sometimes overview. We have also, there is no automatic way of deciding the state space we are learning. We should work more on that. Efficient mechanisms for data generation. So I believe that this could be improved by adding learning by demonstration, including humans in the loop demonstrating the task, which is, this is not easily handled. We also need few-shot learning from few examples, blending in GANs. I'm sure there is many other ways to use GANs in this setting. Of course, intrinsic motivations for goal exploration processes should definitely probably help in this exploration. I hope this was useful, and if you have ideas, I'm happy we should target all this conference here. And here I leave some main references that you can look later at the, I will share like Olivier, the slides. So thank you. Yes, please.
A very general question. In fact, with the algorithm that I presented, when they are using deep networks for performing reinforcement learning, they could investigate. In fact, if you take images as input, these networks should be performing some kind of state representation learning inside the mechanism. I have seen about no paper investigating whether some state representation is learned by this network, and I have even seen no paper trying to insert some of the mechanism you have presented inside the reinforcement learning algorithm so as to favor state representation learning. Am I wrong about this? Are there some attempts to favor state representation learning inside deep reinforcement learning algorithm?
if there are some what per, sorry?
Some attempts to insert or to include some state representation learning mechanisms inside a deep reinforcement learning algorithm.
I have not seen them formulated as such, but I think you're right that it's probably happening and people are not paying enough attention to visualize or interpret these states. I think it would be a good idea to dig more into that.
The point that matters is that probably with what you have investigated, you have the tools to figure out whether some state representation inside the deep network is good or not. So probably these tools could be applied to deep reinforcement learning algorithm to figure out what's happening in them. So that would be very interesting, I believe.
Definitely.
Yeah. Just a comment, you're completely right about looking at the representations that are implicit in the deep reinforcement learning algorithm. We are going to do that. For the integration of this idea into reinforcement learning, we have some paper. One of the figures you presented, Natalia, about auxiliary tasks. As a kid, CID, you have reinforcement learning, learning the value function, the policing, and at the same time, you learn the forward model, the inverse model, blah, blah, blah. And you show that it improves the learning speed. And, so it does not really modify the reinforcement learning algorithm, but it's an auxiliary task that is used and helps learn faster. Mm-hmm.
So to continue on this discussion, maybe one comment and one question. So I think also maybe something that maybe was not is not completely clear to everyone, and an interesting link to what Olivier just said. So Olivier presented a lot methods that do deep reinforcement learning, but with a focus on continuous actions. And actually, the big interest of doing state representations is when you live in a very complicated world, like starting with observations which are directly images and at the pixel levels. And the thing is that in the deep RL domain, pixel levels input has been mostly considered for discrete action reinforcement learning problem. But for I think that for maybe most or even all cases of uses of deep RL with continuous actions, for example DDPG, D4PG, etc., actually they never use images as input.
No, no, DDPG does so.
There are some.
I think you have both.
But in most standard benchmark, I think they're
using CNN as input.
Sorry?
Yes, in the initial DDPG paper, they are using CNNs as input, and the input are the images of the card pole, etc. So they
Because
the state representation inside the network without investigating this.
Okay, but so what's interesting is
they are not integrated. It's a CNN that you train.
Okay, and then what's interesting is that the benchmark on which people focus are actually not using the image as input, but they are using the handmade representation.
These are two baselines. We compare with the same reinforcement learning algorithm using the two states.
Yeah.
The same reinforcement learning algorithm using the image as input.
Yeah.
And the same algorithm again using the learned state. So we make a comparison.
Yeah, you do, but the like the series of papers trying to improve on deep RL algorithms, they don't really compare to the. Yeah, and so actually, so the general question that I had is that you kind of implicitly position a series of works on the state representation in the context of learning a policy. And I guess that, I'm not completely sure, but my understanding is that you implicitly position it in the context of model-free reinforcement learning of policies. But then I'm not completely sure, so first I would like to know whether this is a right understanding or not, and then I'm not completely sure whether, for example, you could imagine learning a state representation before learning a policy. You want to learn a state representation of the world that is going to be useful for learning the policy. You could also want to first learn a policy, starting from the pixels, maybe using the traditional deep RL, the DQN, for example. And maybe it's going to be not very efficient, but at the end you have learned the policy. And maybe after this, you want to learn a state representation that is going to make your policy more compact and maybe to generalize a bit better. And then you could also learn the representation and the policy at the same time. And I'm not so sure in the list of methods that you mentioned whether they are all learning the state representation before, after, or at the same time, or whether they can be distributed in different categories.
All the papers we talk are learning an intermediate representation, so those that there is no models doing end-to-end, so the state itself, it's evaluated or it's there is an internal representation that it's learned. So most of them, I think, are targeted to later being used in a policy, to learn a policy in two